This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
What's up, Wisconsin? It is election day, finally. My goodness, I am so elated and scared out of my freaking mind that we are finally here. It's great to be with each and every one of you here at Civic Media. We've got special election day coverage basically all evening long. You don't need to go anywhere. You can just hang here with us. Certainly no exception today on the Maggie Dawn Show. We got a packed lineup for y'all. You're not going to want to miss a single bit of it. We're going to start out with a good friend of mine and yours. Hang on one second. I'm going to tell you who that is in a second when I bring that guest on. We're going to be joined by Dr. Kristen Lyerly, congressional candidate in the 8th CD, one of those new in-play congressional districts here in the state of Wisconsin, along with Peter Barca, who will also be joining us on this show. I'm going to be joined also by County Board Chairwoman Marcelia Nicholson a little bit later on. Again, so critically important to hear from our local elected leaders. They've got their pulse on what is turning out the vote, especially here in Milwaukee and Dane counties. We're going to also be joined by Melinda Brennan, Executive Director of the ACLU of Wisconsin. And of course, it's going to be Maggie and the Millionaires Talk Money. And I couldn't finish out this election cycle without a little Joe Walsh, folks, that former Illinois congressman, used to be a Tea Party guy. He's all over his support for Kamala Harris. But right now, my great pleasure to bring you all my good friend, Milwaukee County Executive David Crowley. David, welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show. Great to have you.
Oh, thank you so much for having me, Maggie. Big day today.
It is a huge day today. I am so excited that you had some time to join us. What's the feeling out there? I know you were at, I believe you were at Governor Waltz's rally yesterday evening. What was that like? What's your vibe check on the excitement level of voters here in Milwaukee County?
Well, the excitement level is completely off the charts. I mean, not only when you think about the rally from last night, but think about Sunday having former President Barack Obama here, and then having, you know, the concert that they had at Wisconsin State Fair on Friday. And then I've had the opportunity to help launch a few different canvases today all throughout the city of Milwaukee and Milwaukee County. And enthusiasm is up. There are volunteers knocking on doors all over our community. But you're also seeing, you know, some lines in some few of our polling locations, which means that people are showing up. And so I think it's extremely important that we tell folks that not only make sure that you get out, make a plan, and go vote on today, but don't leave that line. You know, the fact that
right.
We have people out there voting every single day, all day today, is a good thing. And that's why I'm inspired and energized. You're fired up and ready to go, as some would say. But I think at the end of the day, we just need to make sure that everybody within the state of Wisconsin let their voices be heard so we can elect our new president, Kamala Harris.
It seems to me, David, that each day the pundits talk about a different demographic group being the demographic group to carry the day. We have talked about the white suburban woman who broke for Donald Trump in both of the prior elections. That's where I place a lot of the responsibility for 2016. We talk about black men voting and how critical that is. The engagement of older conservative women who have become 65 or are in that 65 and older group who may be very appalled by the outcome of the Dobbs decision. We talk about young voters, right? We talk about every single group of people and, of course, black women who have been saving America since its inception. David, when you think about these different demographic groups, is there an issue that comes to the top of your mind that is really cutting across all that demography that really is energizing voters, especially voters who are deciding today whether or not, one, they're going to vote and who they're voting for?
You know, I think that the single issue, you know, that cuts across all demographics, quite frankly, is democracy and freedom. You know, our democracy gives us the ability to cast our vote, let our voices be heard, and elect, you know, individuals who's going to represent us. And what I mean by not just represent us, because there are individuals, even when you lose an election, that still represent you, right? But we don't have that in this election. We have Kamala Harris, who we know is going to continue to be a president, be a representative of everyone and everybody in this country. While we have Donald Trump, who's only going to continue to focus on himself, who doesn't care about anybody who's around him, and who's never really been a team player because it's always been about I for him, himself. And so democracy is on the ballot. But when we think about our freedoms, you know, our freedoms to be able to choose who you want to love, the freedom to be able to make decisions about your own body, the freedoms to be able to read whatever book you decide to read, all of those things are on the ballot. And so these are concepts of plans. He has a plan, and that plan is Project 2025. Let's be very clear about that. But again, Kamala, our Madam Vice President, our MVP, you know, she wants to make sure that she can make things better for working class families. She wants to cut taxes. She wants to make housing affordable. And she wants, you know, individuals who rely on prescription drugs in order for them to do their day-to-day activities every single day, that those costs are lowered consistently. And so we have a true champion in Kamala, and that's why we need to make sure that we get out and vote.
I'm going to have to put a footnote down every time I use the phrase MVP going forward here, David, because I'm going to steal that from you. Madam Vice President, our MVP here on the ballot today. One of the things that really has struck me in these closing days is just the enormous difference in tone from these candidates. And, you know, the campaign has summed it up, I think, pretty adeptly when they say it's Kamala Harris's to-do list versus Donald Trump's enemies list. Do you think voters are taking note of this dark imagery versus the hope, optimism, let's move on, let's turn the page, we're not going back, big tent messaging coming from the vice president?
You know, she's actually giving us something to actually vote for. Mm. I think that for so long, you know, people were saying, well, I'm against this. And it's great that, you know, we can galvanize and be against something. But if you really want to see the energy and galvanize and bring people together and see what they can do with and be energized, you want to bring hope and optimism. You know, hope and optimism is what this country was built on. And when I think about, you know, the opportunities that my three girls are going to be able to have, I can't base that off of fear, because the things that that my girls are going to have access to, the technology and changing and the fact that, you know, we are a bigger melting pot than we have ever been before. When you think about our diversity as a country, you know, we have to give them something to look forward to. And the reason why Donald Trump keeps talking about going back is because he wants to go back, you know, before his felony convictions. He wants to go back because he knows that there are things that he has done that he has to answer for. And he wants to go back so he can change the results. And so if you think that he's going to just, you know, do things and keep things away from, particularly how he's been attacking LGBTQ+ community and making it seem as if we should be against them, well, who else is going to be next on that list, right? And so if he thinks that he can continue to attack certain different types of groups, he's going to continue to do that in order to keep himself in power. And as long as he continues to focus on division, that's what's going to make us weaker as a country. So let's focus on what Kamala Harris is telling us, bringing this country together, because she understands that Republicans are not our enemy as Democrats. We have to work together. We have to find compromise. But it's only one true enemy when it comes down to our democracy, and that is Donald Trump.
Mm. So powerful. Folks, that is Milwaukee County Executive David Crowley, frequent guest here on the Maggie Dawn Show, who I am eternally grateful for. Where are you watching the results this evening? You don't have to describe specifically, Mr. County Executive. Don't want to create any security issues. But where are you watching? Are there any bellwether counties, say, here in the state of Wisconsin or in Pennsylvania, Nevada, that you're looking for? Are you staying up all night? Or are you heading out? Do you have a cutoff time? In other words, what is your plan this evening for the results? I know you'll be watching Civic Media.
I will be watching everything, right? And you know, as soon as 7 o'clock hits, right, then I'm paying attention to what's happening on the East Coast. But as soon as, you know, our polls close, I'm going to be paying attention to everything that is happening within Wisconsin. I'm going to be, you know, visiting some of our local candidates who have ran for state assembly and going to some of those events. But I do plan on going to the Milwaukee County Democratic Party's watch party that they're going to be having this evening. And you can go and learn about that by visiting their website. But I think at the end of the day, you know, no matter what party you're going to, no matter how you're going to be watching these results come in, don't do it without casting your ballot. So make sure that all the listeners, all those who are out there, make sure you vote. And if you've already voted, thank you. But make sure we bring somebody else who hasn't cast that ballot to the polls.
Again, that is Milwaukee County Executive David Crowley. David, I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. I'm here, of course, with Civic Media in our headquarters in downtown Madison, just footsteps from the state capitol. So I'm not going to be there in Milwaukee tonight. You know the respect and love that I have for all of my fellow former public servants and candidates. Please give everyone my best. Thank them for their work. And big hugs to everybody. I hope it's a good night for the Milwaukee County Democratic Party. Have a good time at the watch event. Thanks so much for your time, David.
Thank you, and you have a good evening as well.
Good to talk to you, sir. Folks, again, that was Milwaukee County Executive David Crowley. If you've been listening to the show for a while, you know I worked for that man for a number of years. We have been through it all. David had just been elected county executive back in 2020 in the midst of the pandemic. He took over the reins. I believe he was officially sworn in early June. It may have been even May. So really at the front end of the pandemic. And then, of course, we went into a presidential election cycle. One of the most significant, perhaps until this election cycle, in modern American history. David, as a brand new county executive, was faced with incredible challenges, not just COVID, but also the murder of George Floyd and the protests that occurred that summer. And then, of course, the recount that was requested by the Trump campaign. David was an example of extraordinary leadership in those moments. We can only hope for similar extraordinary leadership from our country's chief executive. We'll be back with more here on the Maggie Dawn Show in Civic Media's special election coverage. Keep it locked. We'll be back with more in just a moment.
And we say, yes, she can. 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 And he say.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
What's up, Wisconsin? Welcome back, everybody. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is Election Day, in case you missed it. I don't know how you could, because it's the only thing that everybody's talking about. We're no exception. I've got a really exciting show planned for you all today. We're awaiting the phone in from Dr. Kristen Lyerly. She is in a hot race, I think would be the best way to describe it, against Tony Weed up in the 8th Congressional District. There's a really interesting interplay, in my opinion, that's been going on. in both the 8th CD as well as the 1st CD and the 3rd CD. Those are the three congressional districts that were redrawn after the 2020 census, making those districts much more purple. This has been fascinating. Each of these three districts, to step back a minute, before the districts were redrawn, right? Wisconsin had, I think, a total of, I don't want to blow this, I believe 8 congressional seats, 6 of which were held by Republicans, only 2 of which were held by Democrats. After the redrawing of the maps, of course, now you have 3 additional seats that are in play. The 2 Democratic seats held by Mark Pocan and Gwen Moore, of course, safe Democratic seats. So these additional 3 seats that are now in purple districts, or more purple districts, certainly in play, which could tip the balance of the Wisconsin congressional district in the favor of Democrats for the first time in a very, very, very long time. And I think it's also an interesting question about whether or not the competitiveness and the campaigns of Rebecca Cook, Peter Barca, and Dr. Lyerly will in fact help boost turnout potentially for Kamala Harris. Or do we see, as we have in the past, ticket splitters, where you have folks that potentially cast a vote for Tony Evers and also Ron Johnson? So this is one of the indicators I'm going to be looking for in some of the returns as they come in these other congressional districts that do not have some of the mail-in ballot counting challenges that you see more predominantly in counties like Milwaukee and Dane. So again, as an early sort of, hey, what should I be taking a look at possibly in the state of Wisconsin to see how things might shake out, I'd be looking at the 1st, the 3rd, and the 8th congressional districts to see where those are going, if those districts get called early or if they're too close to call. Again, those will be, I think, interesting harbingers of the potential way that Wisconsin will ultimately go for the presidential ticket. There's also a really fascinating congressional district and county in the state of Nevada. Now, Nevada historically has been a fairly safe Democratic state, but Clark County, which includes Las Vegas, is a fascinating county. The great numbers of voters in that county work in casinos, right? As dealers, servers, cooks, etc. Obviously, Vegas, the entire industry is tourism and gambling. So that group of workers has been an interesting bellwether of a different sort coming out of Nevada. Now, there's been massive get out the vote campaigns that have been marshaled in Clark County by Democrats and by restaurant worker unions. So fascinating to see how that district, or that county, excuse me, I should rather say, will go. I'm going to be looking at Clark County. It's just a very fascinating state. Again, traditionally a Democratic stronghold, but again, lots of unions, lots of working people there. It was interesting. A lot of the early commentary that I was seeing this morning interviewing voters from Clark County seemed to indicate that it may be up for grabs in Clark County, which, if that goes for Republicans, if that goes for Donald Trump, that's going to get me pretty worried. What do you think? Do you have any prognostications? Feel free to text in 855-75-CIVIC, 855-752-4842. Ham from Appleton. Hello, Ham. Welcome to the Maggie Dawn Show. He says his partner voted for Dr. Lyerly, but immediately when she got home, she went to recycle one of her flyers, and the doctor's flyer gave her a paper cut, so she was a little ticked off about that. I love having a good sense of humor today. I think that's what we're going to need to get us to the final vote counts. Sue from Franklin texting in that she just finished an 8-hour shift at a polling place in Franklin. Franklin, a southern suburb of Milwaukee. She was really busy for the first few hours, and then it was steady. She saw about 2,000 voters, all pleasant and friendly, no issues. Exactly what one would hope for and expect. Busy polling places, lots of observers from both parties, but no major issues. Now, I wanted to share with you folks one of the bits of sound from yesterday that just made me chuckle, since we do need a little levity. It's both serious and a little funny. Now, Cardi, this is going to be the cut of Larry Krasner, the district attorney in Philadelphia. This is Cut 19. Let's take a quick listen about what District Attorney Krasner had to say to those who might wish to disrupt our election process.
I want people to be reassured that when they get up tomorrow to go vote, if they have not voted already, that everybody in this city is working and has been working for months to make sure that there will be nothing tough about that experience and nothing to fear in that experience. But I also want to be clear, anybody who thinks it's time to play militia, F around and find out. Anybody who thinks it's time to insult, to deride, to mistreat, to threaten people, F around and find out. We do have the cuffs, we do have the jail cells, we do have the Philly juries, and we have the state prisons. So if you're going to try to turn an election into some form of coercion, if you're going to try to bully people, bully votes or voters, you're going to try to erase votes, you're going to try any of that nonsense, we're not playing. F around and find out.
Ah, third time's the charm on the old F around and find out from Larry Krasner. Larry, if you don't know who this gentleman is, he was a criminal defense attorney, a very successful one, well known in and around the Philadelphia area. He ran for district attorney, I'd say, about 12 years ago, and has been making waves ever since. You're going to want to stick around and find out. We got great guests coming up next. Keep it locked here on the Maggie Dawn Show. I'll be joined by Melinda Brennan, head of the ACLU in Wisconsin, to talk about their Get Out the Vote efforts. It's coming up next here on the Civic Media Radio Network special election coverage. Keep it locked.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Oh, what's up, y'all? I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We've got your special Election Day coverage. We're going to be going all day, all evening. You're not going to want to go anywhere. We got a great guest coming up in just a moment. Her name's Melinda Brennan. She heads up the ACLU right here in Wisconsin. We're going to talk about the Get Out the Vote efforts. But we got a special guest that just popped in on the phone lines. Can't wait to squeeze her in. Marcelia Nicholson, the county board chairwoman, had to check in with you today, Marcy. Happy Election Day, my friend. How you doing?
Hey, Maggie. Hi, listeners. Happy Election Day.
How are you feeling? Do you think she's going to pull this one out?
Oh, we're going to pull it out. We are so optimistic about this race. Just this past weekend, we had a record turnout of volunteers. We had over 215,000 doors knocked. We made more than 2 million phone calls between Saturday and Sunday. We had tons of meaningful conversations with folks. Early voting started off with a great, great turnout. And the polls, they're so easy to just get into and vote because of the great work of our elections commissions and the fact that you can go in and register same day. And we have tons of polling locations open. So we're feeling really good about the enthusiasm. We're feeling great about the work that has been, you know, put in to make sure we have free and fair elections. and that people could exercise their right. And I'm excited. I'm excited that we're going to elect the first female president, Black and Indian female president. I'm so excited.
Yeah, I am too. It's quite a moment in American history, not just because of the historical nature or historic nature of her candidacy and it looks, hopefully, her presidency, but because of, frankly, the brand, the rhetoric, the platform of the other candidate. It's been, frankly, in these closing days, just shocking. My guess is that this goes down as one of the weakest closings ever of a presidential campaign. Do you think some of these screw-ups, I'll call them that, in this last week or so, including insulting Puerto Ricans, which is an insult to every American. I feel like we're all Puerto Ricans when you hear things like that. Insulting women, J.D. Vance calling Kamala Harris trash. I mean, thing after thing. Do you think these different mistakes, these missteps, are making a difference for voters?
Absolutely. And I want to be clear. As a Black Latina, the representation of a woman of color leading the highest office in the land is meaningful to me. But I'm not voting for Kamala because of that identity. I'm voting for Kamala because she's the most qualified. And she has proven over and over why she's the best person for this job. We've seen her plans. We've seen what she wants to do for the working family, for the middle class. We see what Trump wants to do, which is to continue to make his friends, his VP candidate, I think it's Elon Musk and not J.D. Vance, you know, make those folks richer at the expense of us. And then, as you mentioned, we see these gaps, these insults being wielded. It's almost like his mask is falling off. And it's a sign of weakness because he hates to lose. It's like the kid on the playground, he steals the ball because he lost the game. And that's what he's doing right now. He's going down fast and he's taking down as many people as he can with us. And that should be a clear sign that he is not capable and he should not be our next president of the United States.
Couldn't agree with you more, folks. That is Milwaukee County Board Chairman Marcelia Nicholson. You were one of my bosses at Milwaukee County for many years. What are you feeling from those that are closest to these election processes, our county clerk and our county elections official, the district attorney's office? Have you heard of any problems or were there high anxieties? How are people getting through this election day?
Well, you know, I have to preface by saying that there's always the threat of, you know, intimidation and violence on our election officials. And that is something that has come from the Trump camp because they hate to lose. And so, you know, obviously there are concerns about those sort of threats. And so we're putting measures in place to make sure that our election officials are safe. But we just held a press conference Monday with our youth commission, our elections commission's director, and our county clerk's office. And they talked about how hard they're working to make sure that the count will be done efficiently. They reminded folks that, you know, you may hear that votes are coming in the middle of the night, but that's not true. We have to count every single vote, and we won't stop until they're counted. And so they're going to come in sometime, you know, after midnight. So folks who are listening, don't expect to know the results at 8 p.m. Just know that it's going to take some time to count those votes. And they're being very clear about the process. They're holding very transparent ballot counting processes. And you can actually go to the Milwaukee County Clerk's or the Election Commission's website. Just Google that. It'll take you right there and let you know everything that's happening. I'm confident that they're going to do a great job, just like they have in past elections.
Couldn't agree with you more, folks. That's Milwaukee County Board Chairwoman Marcelia Nicholson. Last words to any voters out there who may not have voted yet or are still on the fence, Madam Chairwoman.
Please, please get out and vote. At the end of the day, it's a power thing. We have the chance to imagine a community that works for us. And we can only do that by playing a role, by participating, by making those decisions and not letting others make those decisions for us. So please meet us at the polling places. They're so easy to go into. Register same day if you haven't registered. Take your ID. Take a piece of mail with your address on it and cast your vote. Your voice is your vote. And finally, for any SNL fans, keep Kamala. Keep Kamala.
Keep Kamala and carry on. And Carrianala, will you hold my Pamela, Marcelia, because yes. I have lots of love for you, as I always do. Folks, girl, I will be calling you later 100% as these results come in. Folks, that's Milwaukee County Board Chairwoman Marcelia Nicholson. Love you, too. Take care. We're now going to bring out my thanks to the chairwoman for making time. I know both she and David Crowley running all over the place. And so has Melinda Brennan, head of the ACLU in Wisconsin. Melinda, thank you so very much. You're going to want to unmute yourself for your patience this afternoon. Got so many people that want to weigh in here. Melinda, what is this election going to mean for folks in Wisconsin? What could the impacts here be?
Well, first, it's a pleasure to be here, especially on this day. I think that it feels particularly momentous for Wisconsin. We have so many elections happening. If people aren't aware of the larger picture in Wisconsin, we have new maps, which means we have the chance for a much more representative legislature than we did previously. And so in order for us to have the resources that we need in our communities, the budgets that reflect our priorities, the laws that we want to govern us in the state, everybody's got to get out and vote. And so this is the day, not just top of the ticket or nationally, but this is the day for Wisconsin for you to reshape the future of the state.
Well, that perfectly leads me to my next question, Melinda, which is, as we look down ballot, so much ink spilt, so much pearl clutching. I have some on myself. So much pearl clutching over that top of the ticket race. It is certainly important. But when we look at down ballot races, especially in our state government here in Wisconsin, what role do those elected officials in the state assembly, state senate, and other down ballot races make in shaping both the quality of life for people here in Wisconsin, but also when it comes to one of the top issues for voters this cycle, reproductive freedoms?
I'm so glad that you said the words quality of life, because that is critical, I think, if we're going to think about healthcare and we're going to think about governmental intervention into our lives. I think that no one should be afraid that they can't receive life-saving healthcare. And I mean that whether we're talking about abortion and that being a major motivating factor for people getting out to vote in the numbers that we're seeing both early and today, as well as life-saving healthcare that impacts folks that are trans and non-binary. And so if you don't want government intervening into the intimate crevices of your life, then I would hope that you would want to preserve the rights that we've expected for 50 years, and that you'd want all your neighbors and friends and anyone you might run into in life to be able to survive and have a life-giving care that they have. And quite frankly, the voting that's happening today shapes our future in relation to reproductive justice as well as healthcare more generally.
Yeah, when I think of these individual issues that we've heard from different voters they may view in silos, I really right. do think of them as incredibly interconnected. It may be a woman's right to bodily autonomy yesterday. It may be an immigrant's right to fair and equal due process tomorrow. It could be your right to marry whom you choose the day after that. It may be your right to unionize. It may be your right to access a free and fair press, so that when we view language and rhetoric like we've heard from Republicans, it may be you tomorrow. That is the sort of grinding, inexorable nature of fascism and otherization. And when we look at our communities, and we think that's not going to happen here, that is my concern. We need to be promoting health and wellness for all. I know that the ACLU of Wisconsin, Melinda, has done an incredible amount of work in door-to-door canvassing. If you could describe that for folks, because the ACLU is nonpartisan. You are a civil rights organization and advocacy group. So tell us, you know, what your efforts have been, and when you do knock doors, what are you communicating with voters about?
So the scope of our work in this electoral cycle has been making sure that every voter in Wisconsin had clear information across our platform of priority issues on every race for the Assembly and the Senate so that they could make an informed decision. So that meant that we sent a survey with several questions, all the same questions to every single candidate. And as they responded, those were going to be the published responses. And I will tell you, you can find it right now on our website. It's equally important today and during early voting, as it will be later for accountability purposes. We wanted people to represent their own political beliefs and what they would stand up for or not in their own words, have people have the ability to read them, judge who they wanted to represent them, and then afterwards be able to hold them accountable. And I will tell you that the advocacy and the comms around that have been absolutely pivotal. No less was door knocking, no less was being on our dialer and our text banking, making sure that people had access to those resources, could find them easily, and no less today in helping with election protection and making sure as voters have problems, they can call the line and get help right then. I'm grateful to say that it's a smoother day than I think many people were expecting across the state. But one of the most important things that we can do is we show up for every single voter and we want people to be informed. And of course, I understand that many people look at the ACLU and they say this is a gigantic platform of issues. But much as you said, I'd like to imagine people's neighbors and friends and maybe people they haven't even met. And you're determining whether they will have a quality life here or not. And so the representation is not just for you, and it is not just a civic duty that all of us that have the privilege to engage in it. It's also for all the people we haven't yet met that we'll be grateful for later that they have their rights as well.
Melinda, so well put. Thank you for that. Incredibly based in this ethos that I think we have here in Wisconsin, which is care for our neighbors, care for our community, yes. Even if we haven't met that individual yet. This yes. is the thing that binds us together as Wisconsinites. Yes. And I think overarchingly, as Americans, this is what is in our blood, if you will. And I can turn on its head some of the allegory used by one of the candidates. When we think about this, and again, the stakes, this is about more than any individual group or any demographic group. Because you have done this incredible analysis, first, let's start with where can people find that information that the ACLU has asked for from the candidates, all the same questions? Where can they find that? And then, Melinda, what are some of your closing thoughts to anyone who may be listening who hasn't yet voted or is on the fence?
I would say, I don't think, to answer your second question first, I don't want anyone who has the ability to vote in weeks later or months later or a year later to be regretful that they didn't get in line and stay in line. So get in line before 8 p.m. And if you're in the line at 8 p.m., stay because you have a right to vote. And bring as many friends as you can with you, because I will tell you, when I was making phone calls the other day, I was grateful to hear so many people had already voted. And the other thing I would say is just go to our website and search for our candidate questionnaire, and you will be able to see all of those answers.
Folks, that's Melinda Brennan, head of the ACLU in Wisconsin. Thank you so much, Melinda. When we come back, it'll be time for Maggie and the Millionaires Talk Money with Erica Payne, head of the Patriotic Millionaires.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
I want to thank you, because you made the army stronger.
When I thought I was young, not too much room.
I guess I
couldn't trust. When I thought I had enough, you were that damn much room.
I guess I
always had enough trust.
Welcome back, everybody. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We've got special election coverage for you all afternoon and into the evening. Got a full Civic Media host lineup. We've got Pat Kreitlow. We have Pete Schwabe, Jane Matt Nair, we got Todd Alba, I'm going to be there. Dom, you're going to see a little bit of all of us. Of course, Earl Ingram, all of your hosts. Don't miss any of it. That kicks off right here on Civic Media across the network and at our website, civicmedia.us, starting at 6 p.m. Want to take a quick caller before I bring on my very special next guest. Caller, you're a Republican and you're voting for Kamala Harris. Tell us more.
Yes, but keep in mind, down ticket, I voted Republican.
Yeah.
But I just cannot.
I love a ticket splitter.
I cannot bring myself. I cannot bring myself to vote for Donald Trump because, and here's the biggest reason. I'm a former Marine, and I swore an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States. If I told that oath today, I would be telling the truth. Mm. If he wins, he would be lying. So that's why I couldn't vote for him. Does that make sense?
Sure does. I really appreciate your honesty about that and sharing your thoughts and your motivations. Get your friends out and everybody keep voting. Although, to the caller, I'm going to ask you to keep listening because the gentleman that is my very next guest candidate in the 1st Congressional District, Peter Barca, I think is a man for all seasons and a man for every voter, whether you're Democrat, Republican, or Independent. Welcome back to the Maggie Dawn Show, Mr. Peter Barca. Certainly happy to have you here on voting day.
Well, Maggie, great to be back with you again and appreciate how much you've worked so hard to keep your listeners informed and obviously one of the most pivotal election days in America's history.
What do you want to say to any 1st Congressional District voters out there who haven't yet voted, Peter, or are on the fence?
Well, excuse me, I would say that you've never had a clearer choice, frankly. Starting with the fact that Mike Johnson, the Speaker of the House, just disclosed the fact. I picked up Friday morning's paper, and I guess I shouldn't have been so astonished, but I was, that he was that candidate. He said that if he's Speaker in January, that he's going to work to repeal the Affordable Care Act. And, you know, as we all know, 4 years ago, they came so close. It was one vote when John McCain gave that famous thumbs-down speech. But now what's even more clear is there's no plan to replace it. They don't have an alternative bill drafted. They never have. And so what that means, and people need to be aware, that means that pre-existing conditions become a problem again. That if you have heart conditions, cancer, or any other serious diagnosis, you no longer will be covered by insurance companies because no insurance company is going to cover people with serious disease unless everybody's covered. And you also need to know that lifetime limits will come back into force. I mean, as it was before the Affordable Care Act, you know, many policies that have $500,000 or $1 million policy limit. If you have a serious diagnosis, that means you're going to go bankrupt. And also your children can no longer stay in your plan at age 26, which my kids did. And so you'd be giving up a lot to go and vote for Brian Stile, who certainly will once again support repealing the Affordable Care Act, if the Speaker Mike Johnson tells him to do so. So that by far is, you know, just so significant. There's what's more important than our health and health care. But, you know, taxes is another issue. I mean, my opponent has voted to give the lion's share of tax breaks to the top 1% again. He's signed off on cutting the corporate rate even further. I mean, it's already lower than what the U.S. Chamber of Commerce called for. And it'll balloon the deficit. My approach would be to give tax breaks to the class so strongly to get there. That's what we did in the state level. Governor Evers and I worked hard on that. And I made a difference economically. Wisconsin did well because of that. But also, I'd like to help small businesses grow and expand. That's where all the innovation comes from, and 2/3 of the new job comes from there. So, you just have a very clear distinction. I'm a person that works hard, has a record of accomplishment, passing dozens and dozens of bills, everything from Buy American to helping to get 100,000 new cops on the, on the street of America and many in the 1st Congressional District. And, I have a survivor benefits. I was one of the lead Democrat, along with Senator Van Wongard, Senator Representative Spiros, and Senator Taylor. I give survivor benefits for police officers still in the line of duty. I led the effort to put the POW on my statue in the rotunda. I mean, in the list goes on. My opponent, by contrast, I've asked people, I mean, tell me what he's accomplished. But that's why so many nonpartisan mayors and village presidents and town officials are supporting me, because there's not that effort. And even in terms of serving people, my offices are open 9 to 5, 5 days a week. These officers are open 2 hours a week, not 2 hours a day, 2 hours a week. It's unbelievable. I've never seen such a pathetic high effort to serve your constituents.
Peter, that fact, when you shared it with me when you were on the show last week, I nearly fell off my anchor chair. Your opponent has his congressional district office open 2 hours a week? That is just it's sort of like flipping the bird to every single voter and constituent in the 1st Congressional District. I don't know how a guy gets away with it. I don't know how he gets away with voting for tax cuts for the wealthiest while leaving the middle class behind. I don't know how a guy gets away with saying he'll vote to end the Affordable Care Act, which is an essential tool for hundreds of thousands of Wisconsinites to get the insurance that they need. Peter, we got about 30 seconds. Say what you would like to those 1st Congressional District voters who haven't gotten to the polls yet.
Well, I can only tell you that I have very strong bipartisan support. And I talked to other members of Congress. They can't believe that his offices are open 2 hours a week. That's why even like one of my former colleagues, Congressman Chris Shavis, a Republican, said, which we're from Connecticut, back when I was in office, was endorsing me. We have many mayors and other town officials that...
Folks, we're going to have to leave it there. That's Peter Barca, candidate for the first CD. We'll be back with Maggie and the Millionaires after this.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.